We will worship, we will study your word, we will fellowship, and we will be discipled, be on mission, and have ministry. And Lord God, we will pray, we will talk to you, we will come to you, and we will fellowship with you, and we will seek your will and your purpose, so that we as a church family can be close to you and express our love and our appreciation to you and our obedience. So we pray that you would help us to rest in you, to know that flesh and blood is never the enemy. We have a spiritual enemy. Lord, we pray that you would defeat him in our presence, day after day after day. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to talk about session 6 of Follow Me, and that is our mission. And so you want to look to Matthew chapter 28, beginning in verse 18. This is the primary text as you were reading the material, and especially if you were in the workbook. And we're going to see most everything. The other scriptures that will be here are simply highlighting one of the truths that are in this passage. And Jesus came up and spoke to them, saying, "All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go therefore, make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age." This passage is one that we memorize. It's one that we allow to become sort of ignored. And so, as we look at a little bit of a video clip, as David Platt talks about his own church and his own desires and concerns, as any pastor would, I just invite you to listen. We're going to start it, and then I'll let y'all know in the back when to cut it. But I think he's very honest about the reality that we face at this time.
So what does it mean to make disciples of all nations? In the church that I pastor, we got to a point where we realized we're talking all the time about going and making disciples. And pretty much everybody in the church can say the Great Commission, yes, we go and make disciples. But we sat back and said, if you were to ask the average person sitting out here on Sunday morning, well, what does it really mean practically to make disciples? You probably get all kinds of different answers, a lot of ambiguous answers, and probably a good amount of blank stares in the process. And realize this is not good. If this is the one command that Jesus gave us before he ascended into heaven, then certainly every follower of Christ needs to know how to do this in our lives. If we're going to do anything well, we need to make disciples well. And I don't think the church that I pastor is alone in this. I think there's a lot of ambiguity and confusion even over practically how does this command to make disciples of all nations play out in our lives? And what does our life look like when we're actually doing this? And so the purpose of this session is, and just as we've thought about what it means to be a disciple of Jesus practically, now to unpack practically what does it mean to make disciples of Jesus. Make disciples who make disciples who make disciples. This is the plan that God has given us for the spread of the gospel to the ends of the earth. This is what we were created for. This is why we've been saved from our sins, to spread this good news of God's grace to every people group on the planet. So what does that mean for our lives today? That's the purpose of this session. I pray that in the end, the goal would be you and I together, nobody sitting on the sidelines in this thing, every single one of us realizing we've been filled with the Spirit of God to be a part of the accomplishment of the ultimate mission in all of history, making disciples who make disciples until the gospel is known among all nations.
Okay, so we make disciples who make disciples who make disciples. Now, from a pastor's perspective, I would have to say that one of the things that we look at, and other pastors the same way, just like he says, we feel like we're disciple makers. That when we get up to preach, when we get up to teach, that we are a disciple you are a disciple. You are involved in discipling me. You come to me, encouraged with scripture, challenged with things, whatever it might be. And we're working together in that. But as I preach, as I teach, that I'm working to disciple this church family in an assignment that I have as pastor. Your Sunday school teacher looks at the people in that classroom, and they think in terms of, what am I doing to help people grow? And yet, I can look at my own ministry situation. Your Sunday school teacher could look at their own ministry situation and ask, are the people that I'm equipping, that I'm teaching or preaching or working with, are they also making disciples who are making disciples who are making disciples? And that's when we come to the realization that something is missing. That there are some of us who are sharing our faith. And it may not be a constant thing. It may not be a regular thing. But there are times when God gets our attention and we do share our faith. People do respond. But you know, you learn things from your life experience. And you know, this is not going to be all David Platt. I can't do that. We're not just going to bark his material to you. God's speaking in my life process about this whole thing as well. I have some seeds in my house. Actually, I have a bunch of seeds in my house, all kinds of seeds. And one of the seeds that I got a while back was chickpeas. Now, y'all, Sherry, she doesn't like chickpeas. What happened was, is we made the trip to Israel. Had a wonderful time. And my wife just fell in love with something awful called hummus. And I don't know if you've ever had hummus before, but she just loved this stuff. She loved it. So I thought, I'll get chickpeas, and, you know, but I couldn't find any to buy for seeds. So I thought, okay, only ones I can find are the ones that were for sale at some store, and so I'll see what I can do. So I take some of these chickpeas out and I plant them. And guess what? Some of them grew. Some of them didn't. Because they really weren't prepared to be seeds. They might not have been harvested in such a way or treated in such a way that made them conducive to be seeds. But some of them, when I planted them, they produced a plant and they began to grow. And so, what was the difference? What's the difference between those at Little Cypress Baptist Church who give evidence of spiritual growth and reproduce themselves by helping other people come to faith in Christ and then in teaching and encouraging them on a one-on-one basis until they're capable of doing the same thing that you just did in their life? Because see, that reason that I planted those chickpeas, and if you look in my garden today, there's some out there. I want some new seeds. I want some new seeds. See, the old seeds, the time is running out on those. There'll be a time when those seeds, there's no way they're going to reproduce a plant anymore. They'll just not be capable. But if I can take those seeds and plant them and get some new plants, then I can get some new seeds. That I have much more certainty that they will, if I plant them in the future, produce. Well, what happens in a lot of churches is you get to the place where most of the people who have the ability, they have the training and the experience to be able to share their faith and make disciples, if they get to a place where they no longer do, for whatever reason, they feel like that their time good is long since passed, or they've had problems in their life, so who are they to be telling other people what to do, or whatever it is that comes up to be the problem, and new ones coming up through the process are not learning how to truly be a disciple because they don't have examples. They don't have someone to watch. They don't have someone to take them under the wing and say, come go with me, I'm going to visit this week. I have somebody that needs to hear the gospel. You can come as my prayer partner. And so they go, and they're terrified, and their knees are knocking, and you're sharing the gospel, and they're watching this whole thing, and they see the Spirit of God at work. It's a thing that requires that people respond to what we see in this passage. Now I want to point out three things in the Great Commission, and some of you are following in your book, in your workbook. Let's see, that would put you on page 148. And so as disciples of Jesus, the first thing we want to think about is believing the authority of Christ. To believe the authority of Christ. Do we believe that Jesus has authority over everything in heaven and everything on earth? If we really, really, really believed it, then wouldn't we also believe that when he puts it on our heart to go and share the gospel, he's going with us? That he has the authority in that situation. That he, as God, can work to open doors and to open hearts. And yes, we know there are times that we're going to go and that person may not respond to receive Christ, but we're going to plant a seed. Or we're going to water a seed that's already been planted. And so the scripture is pretty clear on these things, that if we believe that Jesus is in charge and Jesus has sent us out to make disciples, then Jesus is going to go with us in his power to accomplish that purpose of making disciples. Amen? Amen, maybe? Okay. See, that's our problem right there. Do we really believe that Jesus is in charge of this? Well, I've been so many times, I've shared the gospel with someone and they didn't respond. And I would say, how do you know what's going on in the heart of a person when they hear the gospel? Maybe that person responded to faith in Christ sometime later because you planted the seed or you watered it along the way. Well, the next thing that has to happen in this process of the Great Commission is, how are we going to teach people to obey the commands of Christ if we don't obey the commands of Christ? And this is the reality that, you know, you look in the mirror and you have to ask yourself, David Turner, how are you going to get up and preach and teach and tell everybody to obey the commands of Christ and not be an example of obeying the commands of Christ? And so we have to realize that in this instruction, this command that we've been given, we make disciples of all nations and we teach them to obey. And part of teaching people to obey is to obey ourselves as an example. The last one that you see there, and this is an outline for this whole presentation, not in your workbook, but it says that we must depend on the presence of Christ. Now in Matthew 28, verse 20, it says, "Lo, I'm with you always." And so is there a time that doesn't fit in always? No. Always is always. So when you're witnessing, when you're eating breakfast, when you're driving your car, it doesn't matter where you are or what you're doing. Jesus, if you're a born-again child of God, he is with you always. And so we depend on the presence of Christ for our own spiritual welfare. We depend on the presence of Christ to keep us safe. We're in him. He is in us. We don't keep ourselves saved. Our works don't keep us saved. It is the presence of Christ that keeps us. It is the presence of Christ that empowers us. And so as we're out there sharing the gospel on our mission to make disciples of all nations, we depend on the presence of Christ. So when you begin to wade into what you sense to be an opportunity to share the gospel with someone, you know because the scripture said so, Jesus is there. He's there in his authority. He is there to support us as we obey the commands of Christ ourselves to make disciples. So as disciples of Jesus, let's believe in the authority of Christ. Jesus is, if you're looking at your workbook, Jesus is the universal Lord and Savior over all. And we say Jesus is the universal Lord and Savior over all. We're going to look at this passage in Daniel chapter 7, verse 13 and 14. This passage is an amazing look into the future from Daniel's time. I kept looking at the night visions, and behold, with the clouds of heaven, one like a son of man was coming. And he came up to the Ancient of Days and was presented before him. And to him was given dominion, glory, and a kingdom, that all the peoples, nations, and men of every language might serve him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion which will not pass away, and his kingdom is one which will not be destroyed. So, if Jesus has a kingdom, and it is a kingdom that is represented from peoples of all the world, it has people from every nation, it has people who have spoken from any language, and that all of these people are there to serve him, and that kingdom is never going to end. His dominion, his lordship, his role as king and God over this kingdom is everlasting. It will not pass away. Then you tell me tonight, which country out there, which group of people, which people speaking whatever language, for whatever religious belief, which ones of those people are not under the kingdom, authority, and dominion of Jesus Christ? You say, well, they're not much acting like it. Well, even the church is not much acting like it sometimes. But you see, it doesn't matter if I leave this place and I get in my car and I head down the street and I get out here on Meeks Drive and I just decide, you know, I've always wondered what it's like to be in England. I think I'm just going to drive on the other side of the road. So I just pull over on the other side of the road. I'm just driving down the road. This is kind of nice. I've never done this before. Cars are going off in yards and going across into other lanes. And in a minute, here comes police cars. Police cars come, and I look at those cars and I say, boy, aren't those lights pretty. Those are beautiful. I love those blue lights when they're